Okay, here we go. Stand by.
3, 2, 1.
The thinking atheist. It's not a person. It's a symbol. An idea.
The population of atheists in this country is going through the roof.
Rejecting faith. Pursuing knowledge. Challenging the sacred.
If I tell the truth, it's because I tell the truth. Not because I put my hand on a book and made a wish.
And working together for a more rational world.
Take the risk of thinking for yourself. Much more happiness, truth, beauty, and wisdom will come to you that way.
Assume nothing. Question everything. And start thinking. This is the Thinking Atheist Podcast, hosted by Seth Andrews.
What happens when you're an evangelical Christian and you see the culture slipping through your fingers? You know you are becoming a statistical minority, or at least an equal. You have to share the table with everybody else. Holy shit, I don't want to do that, right? This is my party. This is Christianity's party. We own the country. In God we trust. This is a Christian nation. These people realize at this moment that they are going to have to do something. What exactly are they doing? Well, that's what this broadcast is about, because we are seeing an avalanche of maneuverings by people at the local, state, and federal level who are mobilizing. They are mobilizing with pastors and whole church congregations, whole church denominations. They are preaching in churches as they run for public office. I mean, they're not even hiding it. And in a huge field of options, I mean, all I had to do was just look at the daily headlines to see examples. I've just got a few that I'm going to play for you. I'm not trying to drive you crazy, right? My goal here is not to make you want to put your head through a brick wall. Although that's kind of how I felt about it when I was listening to these sound bites. But I think it's important to get a few examples of what's going on, and then we're going to get more specific about the maneuverings, exactly how evangelicals, the right-wing Christian church, is attempting to do a coup, really. This guy's name is Josh Mandel, former lawmaker and state treasurer of Ohio. This was last month. He was in a debate. He was running for the Republican nomination for Senate. Now, this primary debate for the Republican Party was hosted by the Center for Christian Virtue. Wait a minute. The Center for Christian Virtue is sponsoring the debate? There's a violation, if I've ever heard one. Josh Mandel was asked this question by the moderator. The question was, what's the greatest crisis facing our kids? And what, if anything, can you do about it? And this was his response.
I think the worst thing happening to kids today is that the secular left, the fake news media, the uniparty in Washington, they're trying to take God out of all aspects of society. And they're trying to water down on the Judeo-Christian bedrock of America. And my personal feeling is we shouldn't be watering down. We should be doubling down. We should be instilling faith in the classroom, in the workplace, and everywhere in society. The secular left, the ACLU, the Southern Poverty Law Center, a lot of these Soros-funded organizations, they advance the argument that the separation of church and state exists, and for that reason, you can't teach kids about religion. My personal feeling is there's no such thing as separation of church and state. The framers of the Constitution envisioned a country where in the classroom, kids would learn about God, that in the classroom, kids would learn about good versus evil, and that Judeo-Christian ethic separates itself from Islam and atheism and all these other belief sets on so many levels, but one of the main levels is our acknowledgement of good versus evil and teaching our kids to fight for good over evil.
Now, notice how much he gets wrong, which is pretty much everything, right? The false notion that you can't learn about religion in schools. You're kidding. Of course you can learn about religion or religions in schools. What are the religions? What do they think? What are their deities? What are their holy books and their basic doctrines, their customs, traditions? Of course, you can learn about religion in school. This whole idea that it's been locked out. Now, Leo, he's upset that the school's not operating like a Christian church. Poor, poor Josh Mandel. Then there's that phrase, the Judeo-Christian bedrock of America, right? We already know what's wrong with that. We were not founded on Judeo-Christian values. No mention of God in the Constitution. No religious test should be a requirement for public office. The founders were not all Christians. They set up a country, not a church. I mean, we already know this, right? Then there's that alignment he made. Evil and non-Christianity. He mentioned Islam right next to atheism as a belief set. And he just said it outright. I mean, he was, you got to give him credit. At least he put his cards on the table. When it comes to the United States,
my personal feeling is there's no such thing as separation of church and state.
Now, this just happened in my home state of Oklahoma, which just issued its very first non-binary birth certificate. And that's a whole other conversation. But essentially, the idea is while most people are male or female, some people simply don't fit into those distinct categories. Some people have blended elements that simply don't fit one or the other checkbox. So non-binary is really nothing new. It's not a recent thing, but we are talking about it a lot more of late. And people who are identifying as non-binary are asking to be recognized. So there's a big lawsuit here in this state over the idea of issuing a non-binary birth certificate. We just don't check a gender, or we call it non-binary or whatever. The lawsuit was settled. The first non-binary birth certificate was just recently issued, and our governor was not happy. Evangelical Christian and Oklahoma Governor Kevin Stitt. His protest didn't involve anything like the state constitution or the law or anything like that. No, no, no. As a taxpayer-paid public representative of the entire state of Oklahoma, he decided to invoke his religious faith. And here's a clip about it. This was the report on KOCO Channel 5 News.
The governor wasted no time in releasing a statement saying in part, "I believe that people are created by God to be male or female, period. There is no such thing as non-binary sex." And he went on to say that he'll be, quote, "taking whatever action necessary to protect Oklahoma values and our way of life."
Now, you see what he just did. Oklahoma has 4 million residents, including this atheist. You know, hello, right here, got my hand in the air. And trust me, there's a lot more of us. And there are Muslims, and there are Hindus, and there are Sikhs, and there are Wiccans, and all kinds of belief systems which do exist here in Bible Belt Oklahoma, right? So why is the governor saying that he believes people are created by his specific God to be male or female, and he's going to take whatever action necessary to protect Oklahoma values and our way of life? Essentially, he's projecting his own faith onto the values of every citizen of this state. And he's not the only guy in a position of huge power over a state who is invoking his personal faith. North Carolina Lieutenant Governor Mark Robinson. This is the second most powerful man in the state of North Carolina. And he's preaching. He's not teaching. Right. He's not just running for office. He's not just campaigning. He's preaching at Ashburn Baptist Church in Seagrove, North Carolina. And he's upset about all of these non-biblical versions of sexuality that are being allowed and taught about in public school.
"I was born in L. Richardson Hospital to be one of God's freedom fighters. Bottom line, nothing else. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. I wasn't born to waver, wasn't born to quiver. Yes, I was not born to make nice. That's why my mother named me Mark, after the God of War, because I'm here to literally make war on the devil. I said the other night, I want to make the gates of hell tremble. I just don't want to make the gates of hell tremble. I want to make the literal foundations of hell tremble. And I want this nation to join with me and do it."
Wait a minute, was Mark the God of War? I thought it was Mars. Mars is the god of war. Anyway, you can see, I mean, he sees his appointment as lieutenant governor. He sees that not as a responsibility to the constituents of his state. He believes he was elected, anointed by God to literally make war on the devil, and the devil is apparently a liberal. Here's a guy running for Congress, Mark Burns. He just spoke recently at the Church of Tennessee Hate pastor Greg Locke. He thinks that Greg Locke should run for governor of Tennessee. Can you imagine the horror that would be? And here's what Mark Burns said to the church.
If you really want to see life change, the gospel of Jesus just can't stay in the house of God. We need politicians who will take the glory of God that's in the temple of God and take it to the halls of Congress.
Here's a history revisionist, Tim Barton, who is a chip off the old block because his dad does the same thing. These guys go around pandering to the Christian church and essentially sell a false version of American history where all of our founders were Christian nationalists. So this is Tim Barton, and he's speaking on a live stream called the Truth and Liberty Coalition. Here's what he said about the Founding Fathers.
The Founding Fathers referenced very specific verses as the reason why they were doing what they did. For example, that we have a separation of powers, which was kind of a unique thought at that time, because if you look in Europe under the king, I mean, the king pretty much did whatever he wanted. They said, no, we want to separate powers. And actually, George Washington, Alexander Hamilton, James Madison, John Adams all wrote the reason we needed to separate powers. They said, because the heart of man is wicked and deceitful and can't be trusted. Now, I don't mind putting you on the spot because I know you know the word of God.
Jeremiah 17:9.
Right. They literally quoted and referenced the Bible as the reason we had to have a separation of powers, because they knew what the word of God taught was true, that we can't trust. If you leave it to one person, well, what if that person's heart goes corrupt in that moment and then it's just bad for the nation? So we need to have a separation of powers so there's checks and balances. So if one branch goes bad, the others can hold them accountable. But here's the point is there's actually dozens of examples from scripture that the Founding Fathers literally quoted the Bible for what they did. And actually, if you read the Constitution and then you read the Bible, you will find phrases that are almost verbatim from the Bible and the Constitution. It was Isaiah where the Bible says that the Lord is our judge, our lawgiver, and our king. That's your three branches of government.
Totally, totally not true. Also, have you noticed that so many of these organizations use the keywords liberty and truth and freedom? I mean, there's the Leadership Institute. They're going after school boards. They're trying to stack school boards with evangelicals. Same is true with Freedom Works, the Family Research Council, the Citizens for Renewing America. Now, this brings me to the guy who founded Citizens for Renewing America. His name is Russell Vogt. Well, back in 2017, he was up for the director of the Office of Management and Budget. He actually got the job, and he served last year into January of this year. But he was in front of this committee where they were questioning him to determine qualifications. And none other than Bernie Sanders challenged him on some statements he had made as an evangelical Christian about people who are not Christians. And watch this guy squirm and dodge and deflect. Russell Vogt.
Let me get to this issue that has bothered me and bothered many other people. And that is in the piece that I referred to that you wrote for a publication called Resurgent. You wrote, Muslim, quote, Muslims do not simply have a deficient theology. They do not know God because they have rejected Jesus Christ, his son, and they stand condemned. End of quote. Do you believe that that statement is Islamophobic?
Absolutely not, Senator. I'm a Christian, and I believe in a Christian set of principles based on my faith. That post, as I stated in the questionnaire to this committee, was to defend my alma mater, Wheaton College, a Christian school that has a statement of faith that includes the centrality of Jesus Christ for salvation. And
again, I apologize. I do. Forgive me. We just don't have a lot of time. Do you believe that people in the Muslim religion stand condemned? Is that your view?
Again, Senator, I'm a Christian, and I wrote that piece.
Well, what does that say?
With the statement of faith of Wheaton.
I understand that. I don't know how many Muslims there are in America. I really don't know. Probably a couple of million. Are you suggesting that all of those people stand condemned? What about Jews? They stand condemned too?
Senator, I'm a Christian.
I understand you are a Christian. But this country is made up of people who are not just. I understand that Christianity is the majority religion. But there are other people who have different religions in this country and around the world. In your judgment, do you think that people who are not Christians are going to be condemned?
Thank you for probing on that question. As a Christian, I believe that all individuals are made in the image of God and are worthy of dignity and respect regardless of their religious beliefs. I believe that, as a Christian, that's how I should treat all individuals.
And do you think your statement that you put into that publication, they do not know God because they've rejected Jesus Christ the Son and they stand condemned, do you think that's respectful of other religions?
Senator, I wrote a post based on being a Christian and attending a Christian school that has a statement of faith that speaks clearly with regard to the centrality of Jesus Christ in salvation.
Now, this guy, Russell Vode, is a power player today. And this organization, Citizens for Renewing America, essentially a political organization, prayer warriors training people up to have dominion over the United States government. Again, one nation under their God. Real quick break. I want to talk about Christian Dominion Theology. This is a thing. Like, it's definable, it's quantifiable, it is a mission statement by the Christian nationalist. I'm going to talk about this with a guy who knows a lot about it, a former devout Christian and host of the Mind Shift podcast, Dr. Clint Haycock. We're going to chat about Christian Dominion Theology next. I want to talk more here about Christian Dominion Theology and something called the Seven Mountains Mandate. And to do that, I wanted to talk to Dr. Clint Haycock. He is host of the Mind Shift podcast. Dr. Haycock got his bachelor's from a Bible college in Portland, got his master's in exegetical theology, got a theology degree in the New Testament back in 2003, and then got his PhD in biblical studies from the University of Chester in the UK. And today he focuses on deconstruction and reconstruction. And today he talks a lot about Christian Dominion Theology. Clint, it's great to have you on the show.
Thank you, Seth. Really good to connect again.
Should I call you doctor? I mean, I want to respect the title. You know, it's hard won title.
It is a hard one title. I could tell you horror stories how hard it was to get that PhD, but no, just call me Clint.
All right. We're talking about Christian Dominion Theology. This is very much your wheelhouse. I've set up the fact that you have very much a religious background, religious education. Were you a pastor or minister?
Oh, I was a pastor for about 12 years, an elder and a pastor, and then I came over here to the UK, where I did my PhD, and then I was a teacher at a Bible college for about another 8 years. So, yeah, I was all in most of my adult life.
And you've been dissecting, deconstructing, and not really going after, but you have sort of put a critical eye toward your former faith, right?
Oh, yeah. That would be putting it mildly, but I would say, yes, I don't actually go after Christians. I go after Christian theology. I just did a podcast a while ago sort of breaking down evangelicalism from the perspective of cult psychology, and I kind of broke that down point by point by point to kind of help people to see where the mind control, where the certain tactics lie in terms of evangelicalism. But I don't get a lot of pushback from Christians. Maybe, I don't know, you probably do more than me, I guess.
Yeah. We've been talking about this grassroots effort to start at the local level and go after school boards. I just played a clip earlier from Tim Barton, the son of history revisionist David Barton. Mm-hmm. And he said, and this is a quote, "There's churches in every community. If every church said, we will take over our community, all of a sudden, every community is taken care of. And all of a sudden, what was a national issue has just been solved because we solved it locally." Now, what he's talking about is changing the culture to become Christian. And you start in your school boards, you start with your local pastors influencing the community. Many of these churches are passing out like voter guides on the Sundays before major elections. I don't know, Clint, if I had to ask you to define Christian Dominion Theology, how would you flesh it out for us?
Well, there's several iterations of the thinking. I'm sure we can get into those, but the basic sort of worldview is that they take their mandate from Genesis 1, 26 through 28 in the Old Testament, book of Genesis, in the creation narrative of the Bible, where God tells Adam and Eve in the narrative that you're supposed to take stewardship over the earth and have dominion over it. Now, most Christians read that verse and they read it and they think, oh, we're talking about stewardship, like environmental responsibility and that kind of thing. We need to take care of the earth. But there's a certain section, a subset of Christians, more radical Christians, that read that verse and say, aha, what it means is Christians are mandated by God to take dominion over the world. And they do it in various means and ways, but mostly political. And as you say, like school boards, that's the thinking behind it, is they're trying to take dominion because they believe that's what God's mandated them to do.
They may feel they're losing ground at the national level as the election didn't go the way of many evangelicals. So now they're reversing their focus, right? They're going after the bottom of the pyramid. I don't know if that's even a good analogy, but what's your take on that?
Well, this has been a very long, long game. I'm sure we'll talk about one of the, well, I would say the founder of true dominion theology was a guy named R.J. Rush Dooney. And he died in, I think, 2007. But he was the founder of a certain sect of Christianity called Christian Reconstructionism back in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. And his thinking really has impacted the Christian right. And you know, like you say, Christian homeschooling, this idea of Christianizing school boards. So this thinking has been around a very long time. And for example, we could say, well, the Texas abortion law, that's an example of this dominionist kind of thinking. They've been playing the long game to get judges installed, certainly from the Supreme Court all the way down. So this has been a very long time coming. And now that they see a path to overturn Roe versus Wade, they're thinking, here's a chance to Christianize America. We're going to outlaw abortion, and it's going to go all the way to the Supreme Court. And this has all been set up by decades of work. So this is nothing new.
I guess this stems back to the mid-20th century as we mm-hmm. began to see the Red Scare and then the rise of the moral majority back in the 1980s. You got Billy Graham in the White House. You've got all these evangelical political action committees, whether or not they call themselves that or not. They're essentially PACs. They're political mm-hmm. influencers who have trod over the state church line. And today, what are some of the organizations or people that you've been watching as far as Christian dominionist theology?
Well, some of the biggest ones, the Family or the Fellowship Foundation. In fact, I just had a guy on my show. He's from the Young Turks Network, Jonathan Larson. I've had Jonathan Larson on recently, and he's been doing an investigative series on the family. Now, for those that are familiar with that, there's a series on Netflix that came out a few years ago called The Family. It's by a book written by Jeff Charlotte. A lot of people know who Jeff Charlotte is. And he was the first to kind of blow the whistle on the family. And they are in the corridors of power, not just in America, but all over the world. And they are certainly seeking a dominionist agenda. They're meeting with politicians and leaders, businessmen and women, you know, key military leaders, like movers and shakers of society. And they're trying to Christianize the world. So the Family, the Council on National Policy, Focus on the Family. I mean, these groups are, I would consider them dangerous groups. They really are.
Talking here with former minister, host of the Mindshift podcast, Dr. Clint Haycock. Can we talk about the Seven Mountains mandate? What is that?
Okay, so what you have to do is look at dominion theology, as I say, like a couple of iterations or streams. It all comes out of, I think, R.J. Rush Dooney and Christian Reconstructionism. That was the origins. He was the first one to really articulate what dominion would look like. But his means of achieving that are very, very different than the Seven Mountains mandate. That comes out of, the storyline goes that Bill Bright, who was the founder of Campus Crusade for Christ, and Lauren Cunningham, who was the founder of Youth with a Mission, or YWAM, the story is that each of them back in the 70s received a vision from God saying that the way to impact society was to take over, for Christians, I should say, to take over what they call the seven mountains or the seven cultural facets of society. And that was their world-changing strategy. And the seven mountains are religion, family, education, government, media, arts and entertainment, and business. And I find this tends to be the more charismatic side, because a lot of this involves spiritual warfare. So their basic theology is that atop each of those mountains, there's a demonic presence. and the Christians have to assault those mountains and take them over, unseat the demons that are sitting atop the mountains, and then they'll take over. And if Christians can take over all seven, they will Christianize the world in that sense. So that's kind of the basic thrust behind Seven Mountains Mandate.
I was thinking about, I mean, that's everything. All right, religion and faith, family, education, mm-hmm. that's the schools, government and law, like all government and the legal system, media, news and commentary, arts and entertainment, and business and economics, essentially mm-hmm. every facet of our everyday lives.
That's the key, because then you see those are the people they go after, and that's the difference between the dominionist mentality. This is something that I don't know if your listeners are familiar with Conway and Siegelman, but they wrote a book in 1980-82 called Holy Terror, and they were the first ones who really kind of did a deep dive into the Christian right back in the late 1970s and early 80s. Some of those groups you mentioned, like the Moral Majority and Focus on the Family, the Council for National Policy, a lot of those groups were founded around that time period. And there was a sea change where instead of just evangelizing the average citizen on the street, so to speak, they said, we've got to go after the movers and shakers, the leaders of society on those mountains, as it were, and thereby change the society, the whole nation. It's a world-changing strategy, they would say, to Christianize the world.
I was reading an article in Religion Dispatches. It was by Frederick Clarkson. If every church said we will take over our community, the Christian right revolution starts small and local. I was talking about how mm-hmm. a lot of people are homeschooling more during COVID many times. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's forced and sometimes it's voluntary. But the more you have these sort of homeschool pods, now you've really got an indoctrination machine, right?
Absolutely. In fact, I just had an article that came out. I sent it over to you. I don't know if you had a chance to look through it, but it's in the Public Eye magazine, which is actually a subset of the organization Fred Clarkson works for. I've had him on the show several times talking about Dominion Theology. And basically what it is it's an expose of that Christian homeschooling movement, because if you do the history of it, you find out that R.J. Rush Dooney, who I mentioned before, the founder of Christian Reconstructionism, he was the one who really got the homeschooling and Christian school movement off the ground back in the 1970s and 80s. And his vision was, as you say, if we could just, you know, indoctrinate, or he would say inculcate, he wouldn't say indoctrinate, but generations of young children with this biblical worldview, eventually there'll be enough of them whereby they will take over the society and eventually the world. It's a slow but inevitable march to victory. That's what he, you know, saw it as.
So how screwed are we? I mean, if they can't win in the culture, they're going to go and try to, I don't know, take over these cells or pods and then use those as their circles of influence. But meanwhile, we're seeing an increasing rise of the nuns, or non-religious mm-hmm. people not engaged with religion. How do these two forces play against each other, just from your perspective?
Well, I think I mentioned before, for example, the Texas abortion law. There's also another one in Missouri that's coming up for the Supreme Court hearing. What they're doing now is they're just trying to play the political game. As I say, it's a long, long game. But for example, it's a pipeline. They think of it as a pipeline. So, for example, let's imagine a person like Madison Cawthorn. Okay, here's a guy who's out there promoting the big lie and all the rest of it, but he's a homeschool graduate. He went through the homeschool system, so he would have been indoctrinated with that dominionist sort of worldview, because a lot of the literature, the curriculum is just infused with that theology. Then he goes off to Patrick Henry College, which is expressly built by Michael Ferris, who was one of the founders of the Homeschool Legal Defense Association back in, I think it was 2004, with the aim of getting homeschool graduates into the political and legal fields. That's what Patrick Henry College is all about. So they've got interns. They had interns in the Bush era, the Trump era. They've got people working for judges and politicians. And so that's how they're doing it. They're just infiltrating the corridors of power with Patrick Henry graduates who are homeschool graduates. Yeah, the majority of them are homeschoolers. That's how they're doing it.
In the Religion Dispatches article, it was talking about 17 Colorado communities where the local school boards were targeted by this mm-hmm. Christian coalition. In one town of Woodland Park near Colorado Springs, they had a slate of four conservative candidates in a field of nine. They were vying for four open seats on a five-member board, meaning that if all four of these conservative evangelical candidates
were placed in those positions. You're looking at a 4 out of 5 Christian evangelical majority on the board of Woodland Park's hometown. It's crazy.
But that's how they think about it. And going back to Rush Dooney, you can see that thinking way back in the 1940s. That's what I was saying. This is how long this has been around, because back in the 1940s, after he graduated from seminary, he became a missionary on a very remote Native American reservation in Nevada. And it was there that he formulated this vision. He said, if we could just Christianize this reservation by what you just articulated, getting enough Christians on the school board, running for local political offices, we will then change the culture of this reservation for Christ. And that's the thinking of Dominion Theology, where we have to Christianize these secular institutions by getting enough Christians in leadership positions. That goes back all the way back to the 1940s and 1950s on a Native American reservation in Nevada with a guy like Rush Dooney. So that's how far back it goes.
How niche is this? It sounds to me like, you know, something that the Southern Baptist Convention would get behind, right? Or the Assembly of God's denominations. I mean, this is a mainstream thing or fringe?
Well, okay, so going back to what I was talking about, the different iterations or streams, you've got, this is something Fred Clarkson, he calls it hard and soft dominion theology. So the hard dominion theology would be your Christian Reconstructionists, and there's some very serious people out there. I mean, they're God and guns, and they're libertarian, and they don't want, they're anti-government and all the rest of it. They want to build a theocratic kingdom where the whole of society will be under Old Testament law. That was Rush Dooney's vision. So they're real, real serious. That's kind of a fringe movement. But the thinking, the language has infiltrated all the way through the Christian right. So, for example, I was reading in Catherine Stewart's book, and she talks about her she went to a meeting where the family, Focus on the Family, was doing it was a leadership conference for pastors to get their people to get out and vote, as you were talking about with the voters' guides. And she said the person that was leading the seminar at a church used the Seven Mountains Mandate, rhetoric. And she thought, whoa, this has infiltrated the Focus on the Family, because this has just become common parlance among evangelicals. They are just using the language. We just have to take the Seven Mountains, and everyone kind of nods and they know what you're talking about. So it's becoming more and more mainstream, even though people don't know the history. Certainly, they've never heard of Rush Dooney before. He was kind of a fringe figure, but he's influenced the Christian right massively.
How are they getting, I guess I know the answer to this, but how are they getting away with the voter guides? Huge state church violation.
Yeah, it is. And this is something even Jerry Falwell Sr. talked about with the moral majority. Back then, the Johnson Amendment, I mean, it's a law on the books, isn't it? Churches are not supposed to get involved in the political arena. Back in the 70s and 80s, the way the moral majority got around it was they would say, well, we can't hand out literature in the church. We can't hand out voter guides in the sanctuary. We'll put it on the windshields of the cars in the parking lot. You know, that's how they would get around it. It's off the church property. But with, for example, the Trump era, and this is something Catherine Stewart talks about. She said, you know, one of the things, if you remember, Trump said, we're going to do away with the Johnson Amendment. That was one of the first things he said. And the evangelicals all applauded because they knew exactly what he was talking about. So in other words, right now, a pastor or a church that endorses a political candidate, I mean, Trump had rallies at churches and nothing ever happened, even though technically it was illegal. They know they can get away with it. So they've just dispensed with the Johnson Amendment. It's a toothless law, basically.
They've just decided they're going to ignore that part of the United States Constitution. And then they say that the Constitution supports and defends their specific, well, I guess it would defend the Christian faith in terms of private expression of religion, but they see it as a Christian document.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, that, like you mentioned, David Barton of Wall Builders, he runs this organization out of Aledo, Texas. That guy is probably the biggest proponent of the myth that America was founded as a Christian nation. And as you say, some of them would even say the Constitution is inspired, just like the Bible is inspired in their view. You know, so they believe it hook, line, and sinker. You know, America was a Christian nation, and it should go back to being one again. And this dominion theology is one of the major vehicles by which they see that being accomplished.
Anything else you want to add about Christian Dominion Theology or the Seven Mountains Mandate? And is there a resource where people can go deeper? I always like to give people sort of a place to go if they want to find out more.
Yes, absolutely. Well, one of the best resources, if they really want to dive into R.J. Rushdoonian Christian Reconstructionism, would be Julie Ingersoll's book. I think it's called Building God's Kingdom. That's a really good overview of the sort of baseline of, you know, Christian Reconstructionism and how it has impacted all these various spheres and aspects, like the homeschooling movement, the Christian right, political action committees, and all the rest of it. So she does a really good job of that. If people are interested in that, there's some really good resources. Of course, I've done loads of episodes. I've had people like Andre Gagne and Fred Clarkson and Peter Montgomery of the Right Wing Watch, and I talk a lot about Dominion theology and how it's being tracked in our political sector in America.
Dr. Clint Haycock, you know, it's true that those Bible degrees really have sort of still come in handy, haven't they? You can still lean on that religion, that theological education today, well, right?
Yes. That's one of the ironies of my own reconstruction, not in a reconstructionist sense, but I have to say I've learned something in the years that I've gone away from the faith that I have to think, okay, my education, that's a positive, as you just said, because I know the language, I understand what they're talking about, because I spent all my life as a student or a pastor or a Bible college teacher. So in that respect, yes, I don't regret spending all that money and all those years, you know, working for those degrees.
Yeah, you're doing great work. I'm going to put a link to the Mind Shift podcast in the description box for the curious, with an encouragement for people to go and check out your work. But Clint, I appreciate you having this important conversation on the show. Greatly appreciated.
Thank you very much, Seth. Always enjoy talking to you.
Okay, next week we're going to get more into the Christian school aspect of this with the hashtag Expose Christian Schools. And later on in the month, I believe we're talking to constitutional attorney Andrew Seidel and Catherine Stewart, author of the recent book, The Power Worshippers. That's going to focus more on the courts and the Constitution. Lots to talk about, my friends. Thank you so much for listening today. I will see you back here next time.
Follow The Thinking Atheist on Facebook and Twitter. For a complete archive of podcasts and videos, products like mugs and t-shirts featuring the Thinking Atheist logo, links to atheist pages and resources, and details on upcoming free thought events and conventions, log on to our website, thethinkingatheist.com.